might go significantly down as the players be quite exhausted inside the booths. But here we go. Pick and ban up for game one. Rocks Tigers on the blue side. Jace, yet again, going to be banned away. He's just been such high priority since 7.2 hit.
Speaking of priorities, Tigers haven't done a lot of winning, so they don't have a lot of champions with a big win ratio. One of them actually is Sangyun, who's 4-1 on Jin, which on a team that is 1-5. So let's talk about what that means. He's 1-5 on Ashe, and he's not 1 on any other AD carry. So Jin has basically been the only winning strategy for the Rocks Tigers. Now, do you ban it away on red side? That's a little bit more tricky. But blue side, I'd like to see a Jin ban or a Jin takeaway considered for MVP. But when it comes to MVP, it's a lot trickier to ban against him because you already see Sion in the first round, not even a second round pit draft, but a first round. I think that's actually a mistake just because they've actually been only picking Sion in the second round. They're not worried about teams taking away the Sion. So clearly, ADD, Ed, the many-faced man in the top lane, is happy to counter that particular Sion pick. Aris banned, so we're waiting to see what sticks out. Rengar is certainly one that could go over.
Well, Camille will be banned away here by the Tigers, so MVP could just choose to ban the Rengar or take something else off the board if they're feeling comfortable enough letting that through. Seems likely that that might be the ban away. Keep that out of the hands of Songwon.
Actually had a pretty decent performance on Rengar the one time we saw him play it, so we'll see if there's any respect necessary. Rengar has made it through so often in recent days, but with the recent data point, they decide to ban away that Rengar. Kha'Zix is the strongest meta jungler, with Graves not being favored by a lot of these teams. I suspect Beyond may be playing the Graves.
I mean, that was such a big pick for him back during Summer Split when he really debuted and was hard carrying MVP at some points into the game. This would be bold, but I think it's just going to be a jungler coming through. Olaf, something that has fallen behind a little bit as far as the picks goes, even Spirit straying away from it since the Graves has been so strong.
Hey, Longzhu took down SKT with Olaf top, so all bets are off when it comes to...
You got a good point.
Some of those more... I mean, the Edge meta picks have largely worked compared to perhaps conventional wisdom. Speaking of working picks, the Elise has actually been the most consistent for Beyond. 5-2 has been picking that whenever it's available, so... Another series with no Graves, or at least another game with no Graves, raises my eyes a little bit, but that's the world we live in. And the Jin takeaway, this would be, again, given how core it's been to Rox's few victories, I don't necessarily prize Jin over Ashe necessarily, or the other flexible options available. But if Sangyun actually takes some advice from Bang and visit Ezreal School, because that's a pretty safe option against Jin in particular when it comes to the meta AD carries.
Yep. Sangyun just vying for the day that Kalista comes back into the meta so he can snatch that one up again.
Well, if they wait long enough and don't see a tank, there's always an outside chance, Kilios. Hope against hope. It's not shy in the roster, but still Lindarang seems to be favoring the tanks. Maokai, one of the few tank tops that will be taken as a priority in the first round. May even have that Baron trio of Cassiopeia locked in the next round of the picks if it's available for Mickey, who came oh so close, you have to remember, to hard carrying on the Cassiopeia last time they played, but crucially, was still a defeat at the last for Mickey against Jin Air.
As far as ADD's champion, Poi's got a lot of different options that he could go towards. Something he's played in the past, the Poppy, he's tried the GP, didn't come up with a win on that one. But Nautilus, as well as Kennen, are all picks that he has ran in top lane so far.
And that's one of the reasons why I'm surprised to see Maokai such high priority, because okay, ADD has played four games of Maokai. He's actually not picked up a win on it. They haven't necessarily had the same reliable Maokai play that you'd expect. So he might actually run the Kennen that he's played already once this season, even though Marin struggled with the on-hit Kennen he innovated. Nalzahar falls very throughout down the draft. Certainly a bit more of a meta pick for Max. And in the next round, we're looking for mid lane and also the support on the side of Rocks Tigers. So that's why you see support bans come through. He's trying to find as comfortable lane as possible. We see a Kennen ban as the last ban for the Rocks Tigers. Or do they feel they can contain that Kennen in just the same way that Marin's Kennen was contained just yesterday?
I mean, that's if they're, you know, really considering that Kennen. They only played it just the one time.
But it was, again, into the Maokai. It was very much killing the lane-focused build. And except ADD's been carrying. I mean, he played the Camille twice last time out. Surprising to get it available twice. They will ban the Rumble instead, so the cannon, if they want it, is available for MVP.
You have to expect that Malzahar not going to be a flex pick. I mean, Ian could run it in mid.
Yeah, I think it, but I think very much it will be a flex pick in this scenario.
Hasn't played it yet in spring.
Malzahar is really easy, Achilles.
Oh, I'm not saying that it's difficult. I'm just saying it would be the debut of it for him. And okay.
So this Renekton is not necessarily a strategy that works so well for Marin trying to run the Renekton into Maokai. The one thing it does give you is early pushing. Not many champions can push in Maokai, but Renekton is one who can do that. So if Beyond wants to path very aggressively in the very early levels, I think Renekton has a very happy time, but it does get much worse over time for this Renekton, who you have to think they're going to have to hit pretty specific power spikes in order to make it work. Zillion locked in, probably going to be, well, I guess it's hard to say, could be a support Zillion. We're going to find out in this round of drafts anyway. Sivir and Zillion would certainly be one of the more creative bot lane duos we've seen in a meta that felt very enforced when it came to meta picks. But let's wait and see what we have to make and understand. Doesn't necessarily feel like a super Mickey pick in the Zillion, but perhaps he'll have to be on utility duty.
I mean, the court key is there for him. It's been something that he's been, you know, very reliable on, but it's actually going to be the Ryze coming through.
So
Cassiopeia open for Ian if he wants to take that snatch up, but the Syndra as well. It's been a big one for him.
Yeah, 100% win rate for the Syndra. You might think, okay, but they've got a Zillion, why bother? But, you know, Zillion can certainly be baited. You just force the support Zillion to ult himself, doesn't really have any resists or health, and can just be trained down. But there is a world where, you know, it's going to be a very useful tool to have the corner shift against the Syndra.
There's technically a world where that's a support Syndra as well, but seems rather unlikely.
I think you're pretty happy with Malzahar because the suppression onto Zillion, he can't ult during the suppression. So target selection, especially in the 2v2, is pretty straightforward. Unless Spell Shield is down and the Zillion is not in lane, I think he's just going to ult the Zillion, so we'll see if they can get some snowball through the bot lane. I like that MVP have taken away the Jhin, given just how strong the Jhin pick has been for the Rocks Tigers. Otherwise, very balanced draft from Rocks. What do they need to make things work? Is it the lineup purely? Is it the picks? I mean, that part is kind of remains to be seen. Taking the Sion and the Maokai very, very early. Not going to be necessarily an easy laning matchup against Jhin and Malzahar in the bot lane.
Yeah, and we have to see how Mickey's going to do with this Ryze coming in. It's been, you know, hit or miss so far during this split. A couple games, as mentioned, where, you know, he's just trying to hard carry. Does so much work for his team, but the rest of them aren't there. So we'll have to keep our eyes on him, how he's going to be impacting the map, utilizing those realm warps to move around and try to create picks for his side of things. But Ian back over onto the Syndra. Big comfort on a lot of these champions here for the side of MVP. But ADD's Renekton, a bit of a question mark on this.
Just watch Beyond. He's the one who's going to set the pace of this game. He has two pushing lanes or pressure lanes in the Syndra versus Ryze and also the Renekton in top. So if he can invade, keep up his level of play, which honestly has been pretty exclusively on that Elise, that could unlock the early game, the snowball will start, and I don't think even a Zillion corner shift will be enough to stop MVP.
All right, well, let's go ahead, jump straight onto the rip for this game one. Tigers desperately trying to avoid ninth place. So try to get a win right here. Almost a Porky Pig right there coming out of my house.
Really, right. ADD? Kull start Renekton, huh?
Okay.
I don't think I've ever seen a melee champion start Kull, ever. In any region.
I can't dispute it. Meanwhile, Boots coming out for Maha on the Jhin. So, not too surprising to see that happen. And maybe the dragons have given us their blessing yet again, because it's going to be an Infernal Drake starting off for us.
Suits MVP, who should have the early push lead. I'm tracking Beyond pretty extensively this game. I want to keep up my high expectations for him that I had after a lot of great MVP level performances, which is awkward to say when you're talking about a team named MVP, but he was pretty much exclusively picking up those most valuable player points when MVP was having a good run back in summer of 2016. A bit more shaky this season. At least has been the best of those picks for him.
going to wrap down towards the Raptors here. I'll clear those out for Beyond.
ADD, the many-faced man. If you've watched the Gangnam Stadium cast, you'll know that he has asked to be called Ed, but it's because he had a mistranslation of his Korean name and romanized it. Of course, all Korean players are required to have a romanized or English language name rather than Korean scribe, and thus ended up with ADD. So ADD, Ed, Ad, Many-Faced Man. We'll just go with pure Game of Thrones references, even though you haven't seen it, Achilleos. The one time I can say there's something topical that you have not seen.
You've got me beat there, but then again, you always have the upper hand when it comes to TV shows.
Hey, a TV man and a movie man. That's why we work, you know? You got to have your yin and yang in the casting booth.
Makes sense.
Be able to push up in the bot lane.
You watch the Emmys, I watch the Oscars.
No one watches the
Emmys. No one does.
I don't know about award shows in this day and age. Especially within the YouTube age, I feel like award shows kind of lost their luster. There was definitely a time when you would watch TV just to see trailers and previews because there wasn't really any other way to get access to them without going to the cinema. But now, on-demand media of all kind means that sounds like a lot of those award shows and other kind of tangential things have kind of faded into irrelevance, sadly. I hope the Emmys are never a main sponsor of LCK. I've ruined that one.
You shut that down. It's okay. We still
or if I ever get famous enough to host the Emmys, someone's going to find this like audio clip from an LCK game 20 years previously and be like, he didn't like the Emmys very much then.
To be fair, you might already be famous enough to host the Emmys.
Ooh. Now you're not hosting the Emmys either.
We definitely put that one in the ground. All right, though. Linderong looking to put ADD in the ground. Songwon arrives, takes him out with the Void Spikes. And that's first blood over to Rocks.
Sometimes it looks easy.
Yeah, ADD having a bit of the Marin syndrome.
It was overextended with his Cull. Not even the Doran Blade worth of stats means that he's easily taken down. I really don't know why he started Cull. He started Cull and his jungler didn't path around him, so got what he deserved, I guess. As, you know, it would make perfect sense for Rocks Tigers to win this series, given what's happened this week.
I mean, it's one of those things where, you know, you just start typing in all chat, like, GG, jungler didn't gank me.
It's just opposite day, or opposite week, Achilleos, when it comes to results.
It's been opposite split, to be fair.
I mean, KT and SKT are one match defeat at the top of the table, so we can't necessarily call it opposite split, but it feels like everything other than the standings is in complete disarray. The odd makers are definitely the winners, so for all you guys doing some creative betting over the LCK, not been that fruitful, I imagine.
Wait, ADD going in on some, getting some trade damage here. Beyond roaming down, he's going to get spotted. Could be a 2v2. They know that Songwon is here.
The information advantage
is here. They know that
Rocks.
Beyond is here. But no one knows that they know.
So who will be the first to react? ADD is the one who's pushing up the most. Same levels, actually calling in Ian as well.
Will also get spotted up by the ward, which should just be the full retreat here for Linderong and Songwon. Big time investment. They're going to push forward.
And it's still here.
ADD takes a lot of damage. Beyond goes forward. ADD going low. Might have to flash out of this one. Stun not going to connect. And that's actually Linderong coming up with a kill. Ian, not level 6, won't be able to find an answering kill. And already Rocks getting things moving here. Two up over MVP.
Huge cost to the movement because MVP actually bring their mid lane atop. It wasn't spotted by the ward, but information was out there as Mickey was recoiling. Mickey got basically a free back. Timing will come to lane. Not much of a CS advantage, but Mickey didn't have to be drawn top, and it ended up being just a kill over to the Tigers. So MVP lose in multiple ways, and that's why they find themselves 1,200 gold behind already.
Yep. Maxo trying to jumpstart this bottom lane for he and Maha, getting a lot of damage in onto Songyun. Can't spell shield those minions, the Voidlings rather.
Honestly, Songyun being able to stand up with the Sivir lane, Sivir Zillion, a pretty gimmicky lane, but standing up just fine to the Jhin Malzahar so far. Once you get a couple of levels in a BF sword especially, a bomb into a Q, not even with a ricochet, is probably going to be full wave clear, because you do max that Q first, whether you're support or mid lane Zillion.
Quite a bit. Easy Maha is trying to shove this lane up so he can get a nice back in. We'll see Yomu's coming out for him rather shortly. Level 6 hit by both our mid laners. So this is where we have to keep our eye on Mickey and whether or not he's going to be realm warping into a lane. So far, ADDs has been the party lane.
I don't think you'll have enough pressure relief from mid lane to actually be able to roam very freely and be pretty accountable. You see multiple people roaming through the mid lane. Clan's still up on Mickey, but may not be enough if the follow-up CCs are there. Burst damage certainly there, because we're talking about a Syndra. Chain Vest first means that Strong doesn't take that much damage.
Yeah, still will, you know, come out below in trades, but has the sap magic to keep himself relevant. So, won't be getting shoved out of lane anytime soon, especially with two more Corrupting Potion charges still in the inventory.
You have a bit of pause when you see a Maokai winning, I mean, any champion winning lane against a Renekton, but Maokai CS-wise after the successful gank, and also with the kill and assist in his purse, has a lot more gold than ADD, and is winning trades now. That's worrying.
Yeah, definitely a cause for concern. ADD is able to get a bit of damage or HP back with Cold and Meek. He needs to stack up that rage, get above 50% so he gets that additional health back.
We're just camping ADD now. He doesn't have any combat stats still, only damage.
Bottom. This is beyond nearby. He needs to line up that cocoon. Connects onto Songwon, not Lindarong, who's taking up the tower. Still might be able to come up with the kill. Songwon goes
kill.
Into the ultimate. Won't be able to get out.
Oh.
Lindarong tries to trade one back. Cannot do so. ADD barely makes it out with his life. The Dominus enough to keep him up. And that's two kills on the board now for MVP.
Song
into the bottom lane, meanwhile, getting hit up by the Nethergrass straight into the root from the Deadly Flourish. That's a kill going over to Max. Support Jin here to help out.
A double level 6 observed just before Key was able to get his. He's probably only a couple of minions away. One dies the turret, so it was more than just a single minion, but still punished by MVP. And in many different ways, all three kills coming in an instant. Maokai was doing so comfortably on top, they tried to push that advantage with a sheer turret dive against Dominus, still available. Extra health was enough time to allow Beyond to come in, and big punishment onto the Rockstar.
I mean, he was already waiting in the wings, was about to recall, but this was just so fruitful for MVP. Beyond just happened to be there, right place, right time.
The side of a fruitful gank is a fruitless overextension from the Rockstar. Because remember, they were winning straight up. The itemization was looking great. They punished the Kulbai. They didn't need to force that hard. Turret diving a Renekton post level 6 is so rarely the right call, even if you're bringing in at least one ally. So, pretty consequential mistake for the Rocks Tigers, especially with MVP getting a straight up kill on the other side of the map at the same time.
Yep. See which way ADD wants to go with the Tiamat. Didn't seem much other than the Titanic Hydra for quite some time.
Ravenous used to be the build, but you kind of need to rush it straight up and not get the Black Cleaver till much later. So much more power in Tiamat into Phage, and then you kind of miss the window for Ravenous Hydra to be super consequential. It's still an option, but it really does feel like it pigeonholes you into a sideline play. And then you think about side lanes, and Tiamat actually provides you, I'd say the Titanic Hydra is probably more reliable wave clear, just given the auto attacks are also pushing the lane. So I think given that you're going to build health at some point, might as well profit and get the Titanic Hydra.
I'm still a little ways away from stacking up that call at 73 CS. So a bit more to go, a couple more waves, and ADD will finally be able to cash out. Couple that with the kill and the assist that he's able to net himself. And he should be comfortably ahead of Lindarong, though not by too much. Meanwhile, Beyond and Ian, they roam down, they start up this Infernal.
Five members building damage means that Infernal is going to be very relevant.
It's going to be a mountain to follow up.
No pure tanks here.
Songwon just really trying to pick on ADD at this point. But the wave's pushing in. You can see ADD. He's not going to be trying to overextend.
All right, let's
too
do it
much.
Again, guys.
Yeah, they could just go for the dive.
Mach 3.
MVP, they're all in the mid lane, though. Just Maha alone. Out of bottom, Dominus comes out immediately. ADD down to half HP. Should get a nice burst back. On the call to Meek, slice and dices through. Lindarong has to flash away. Turret shot comes through onto Songwon. No one able to arrive in time. Mickey is up here to try to keep them safe.
Lindarong and Songwon have played together exclusively almost. It felt like they rotated in for Ixu and Lyra very frequently on the Afrika Freaks. And yet, I don't know what they see in these turret dives. You're turret diving Dominus available, level 9 Renekton. Sure, Maokai bought an early chain vest, had at the time a Ruby Crystal, but Songwon doesn't have the damage to get these takedowns. just seems like a waste to go. Such aggressive moves, they lose out on lane posture, they lose out on map pressure. All for a low percentage kill, as meanwhile, once again, it's a 2v2 kill.
Hello, alright, so Max yet again coming up with a kill, 2-0 on the Malzahar.
I mean, you can infer that with Zillion roaming, that was a vision play that was made by Max with flash ult.
Yep. I mean, you can even, we'll get a replay of that one, I'm sure, but...
Doesn't leave a lot to the imagination.
I mean, this is a risky spot to be in for Songyun because there's so many things that can bait out the spell
shield.
It's
just a vision play.
Just flash.
Instant ult.
Hello.
Very, very hard to twitch that particular spell shield. Had about 0.2 of a second as there was actually a stutter step forward for the Malzahar before he ulted. Didn't get it. Fell. ADD returns to top. Will actually pay off his cull with this particular minion wave, so he's got that going for him. As you can see, one CS away from a cash-in that will extend the gold lead for MVP. Was well punished. I liked the pathing early to get the first blood onto ADD. Songyu's had enough of these Malzahar hijinks. They've died twice in the 2v2, so ending the laning phase, as we saw Samsung do yesterday.
I'm just going to send everybody.
Well, Renekton doesn't do much in the 1v2. It's the reason why he died away as a pick during the lane swap meta. Let's turret dive him again.
We
brought back up.
He's probably going to go down this time. Oh, almost made it out alive.
What about Rock's members?
Get finished off with a ricochet. Songyun picks up the kill. MVP and Beyond arriving. First turret gold going to go over to MVP in the bottom lane as they work that down. Now it's Ian and Beyond against the world. Desperately trying to hold this turret. He does not have his ultimate. Ian, a little bit low on mana though, still has a good amount of wave clear as you can see. Completely wipes out that back line. And Rox, they won't be able to come up with it quite yet. They want to stick around for a few more waves, maybe they'd find it. But this just gives Maha a couple times to rotate through the pistol. Get some nice damage in onto that turret, almost works it down to half.
Nothing Rox does is elegant this game. They're brute forcing upon brute forcing. Sure, they get a kill, but they don't even take the turret Achilles. They just have MVP, pick up more minions because they're not sharing experience between five members. They don't care if they don't pick up the kill. They actually gained gold despite all of that with getting both first brick and also plenty of minions. 21 CS advantage now for Maha. I just don't know why. I feel like Rox have had some good performances. They might not have match wins, but they have a lot of single game wins, even against more difficult opposition so far this season. But especially in this game, the level of brute force, not something we often see in Korea, so a bit troubling to see Rox just go see hero, kill hero, when so many other options and avenues are available to them with this draft.
Yep. Max coming in, gets the nether grasp in onto Mickey. He will flash away the stun. Scatter the Weak will not connect. But still, it's going to be flashed down for him.
Probably they could have overlapped their CC ideally there, but it seems like Ian didn't have the setup.
Lands the stun. Cleanse immediately comes out here for Mickey. Wasn't in range to use that Unleash power to try to get the kill. Almost certainly would have taken him down, but Key would have been there for the Zillion ultimate, so he would have just came right back to life.
He pushing up super aggressively. No respect given whatsoever in the bot side. Remember that Jhin can't even get to bot lane, but now with Kha'Zix and Sivir being drawn to top lane, playing the map very well at MVP.
Maha's got to be careful. Sungwan is stalking around this top side of the map. He'll walk into the brush, he'll find that control ward. He'll be able to kill this.
The reason why I'm so surprised with Rock's space that Maha might be caught.
Yeah, gets jumped on, but here comes Max. No, the nether grasp available, but does have the exhaust.
If you just think about late game, Achilles, Rocks have so many tools that can work so well against MVP. They can play three lanes better once the Maokai starts to fall off. So once the Renekton starts to fall off, they have Maokai, Ryze, Sivir in the late game. Sivir is still very, very strong as a three-item AD carry. It feels like the scaling war is pretty squarely in their side, so why overinvest in dive after dive after dive where going even or trading objectives seems to be what their comp, all it really needs.
Yeah. Been really poor decision-making from Rox, not just in this game, but you know overall that's what's kind of led them into this eighth place spot at the moment.
And I don't think that's something you can give this lineup. You might say, okay, it's not the same Rox Tigers last year. Don't really need to talk about that anymore, but this is basically the Afrika Freaks. There's not a lot going on that's different here. Sure, Key is a new support. but he is a support with experience, has played at the highest level. So I don't know how much latitude you can really give them for macro mistakes. They shouldn't necessarily have them. If a freak of freaks, the current iteration, have macro mistakes, you can be like, well, how many games have they played together? These guys came together right at the end of the offseason, got the best available, and now trying to learn at the highest level. You can get that, but ROX should be better macro-wise than they are. If they get outskilled by better players, that's one thing, but macro mistakes is not something I'm willing to forgive them for.
Makes sense. MVP now trying to hold on to this top turret yet again. Meanwhile, the Mountain Drake does go over. So Infernal and Mountain, a nice start from them. And they're already utilizing it, just whittling away at the rest of that Tier 1 mid turret. So now the top, the only outer remaining for ROX Tigers. And you can see they are just slowly getting choked out of this game.
I just want to keep pushing it up to MVP. Haven't called Bjorn's name much, but has farmed well. Not often that a Elise will have a significant farm advantage over a Kha'Zix, but that's happened this game.
Yep, and of course you can see the very aggressive build as you would expect from Bjorn. No proto belt, but still building towards that Liandry's.
He doesn't want to build for team fights. He wants to build for getting picks next to structures as they continue to accelerate the game. 4,000 gold lead for MVP. Cocoon needs to spell death. Cocoon into the W from Renekton should observe kills. Malzahar, Syndra, Jhin can all catch. Speaking
another
of catch.
Grass down onto Key. Can't even use the ultimate on himself. He just gets decimated.
You know, it's another ultimate that wasn't needed. Woo. Ian did not need to ult either, Achilleos.
Yeah, it was just the scatter of the week was plenty of damage. Enough to take down that squishy zillion. Lindorog still desperately swinging away at that turret in the bottom lane, trying to trade something back for his team, but MVP come up with a kill. They won't be able to get that tier 2 turret quite yet. Wave clear still going to be there from Songyun. Meanwhile, Ian coming up the wall. Mickey, one shot from dead.
Anything.
There we go. Fourth and final shot finds it. Maha lines him up, takes him down. 1-0-2 on the gen.
Only two kills, though. Was worth noting that ROX picked up an objective, first turret of the game, so two kills, probably just slightly over the edge when it comes to the worth factor for MVP, but they get down Vision. They were able to take the Rift Herald on the backside, then that was definitely a worthwhile trade for them, but actually pretty even, all things being considered, just because they were trained on the kills rather than necessarily the objectives there, MVP. ROX able to push in minion waves as well.
They'll finally be able to get this turret by the look of it. Not many people from MVP roaming up to defend this, and it's already got a sliver of HP, so it's not really worth it.
Yeah, Jin's roaming up to kill them anyway, let's be real.
And there it goes. All right.
Teleport coming in also from
Bjorn
MVP.
Finds Key. He gets silenced yet again. Can't cast anything. Can't use the flash or the exhaust. He gets taken out. Songwon goes low. Realm Warp comes through as Mickey arrives, trying to defend his jungler, but they won't be able to take away the blue buff. Ian, yet again, will just snatch that up for himself.
Playing the Zillion into the Malzahar suppression and silence, as you mentioned, Achilleos. And into Max, of all people.
I mean, look at this, though. Baron coming through. Songwon had to recall. No way to try to jump in to get the smite.
Yeah, it's going to die very fast.
And it's already gone. Mountain and Infernal really helping out. ROX are trying to push in mid. This is really dangerous if they get pinched on.
Well, they think the MVP's low in health, but because of the Voidlings and Spiderlings, they're not Achilleos.
They're wrong. He's going to get rooted. Goes through. Gets on to ADD, who has to flash out. Dominus does get popped. Meanwhile, that's going to be Lindorong falling with the Zillion ultimate is there, but a double stun comes through. Ian, can he find the follow-up? Curtain call.
Maha.
Opened by Maha. Can he find a prime target? Will chunk out Mickey quite a bit. 655 on the last shot, but no one is there to finish him off. So no kills coming through for the side of MVP, but they net themselves a Baron at 20 minutes.
Yeah, ROX made two mistakes that they didn't respect. Infernal Drake, Mountain Drake, also Elise plus Malzahar. Sure. The Voidlings aren't as strong as tanking it up, but the Spiderlings are still the same, and we're doing the brunt of the tank work. And then they pushed mid, thinking they'd be fine. But once again, because of all the pets tanking up the Baron, they were much healthier when it came to the turn. They didn't have to recall. And sure, it didn't pick up a kill as a bonus, but the gold lead again increases. The Baron is now off the map. MVP look really clean. This is the MVP that were able to beat KT, an even better version, although the opposition certainly is in a different league than KT Rolster. Not literally, but definitely figuratively.
They definitely look like they're in a different league, but they are, in fact, playing.
Which
the
league
LCK.
Would they be in, Achilles? I'm leaving you the bait.
Oh, dear. NACS.
Whoa. Hey. I think Rocks Tigers do all right in NACS. They could beat Gold Coin United.
That's an insult.
Take that, Mad Life.
I mean, who do you want to insult? Mad Life, Loco Doco, whichever. Take your pick. Phoenix.
Two friends.
Plenty of Koreans that you could throw that one out.
All three friends of the LCK, given their previous stints in this league. All three of them not stomping
Miso.
NACS much they wanted to. Exactly, Miso. A good type of soup, and also the old name of Phoenix, who was a top laner.
Of player. He's leveled up, though, from those days. But they were dark ones, indeed. Tier 2 turret goes down. His MVP picked that one up.
Ironically, was on MVP.
That's oh wow, yeah. Oh boy, Ian, you're overstaying. You're welcome, my friend. All alone, Deadly Flourish won't do much to save him. Songwon goes low. Will get popped, but Zillion ultimate keeps him alive. So Ian just a bit too aggressive. Pace for that one, loses the Baron buff.
Zillion ult so much harder to use from the support role. Mainly because you're so insanely squishy as a support that you don't have Rod of Ages or a Zone Years or any sort of hope of living through a fight, that you die during a silence build, and that silence is only 2 seconds, Malzahar suppression. There's so many different ways to kill a Zillion that pulling it off is actually very tricky for Key.
It's also a lot easier to just anger your teammates if you cast it on yourself. Whereas, you know, if you're in the mid lane, use it on yourself, well, whatever, I'm the mid carry. Use it on yourself, well, you're the support. Look, save me, I'm the AD carry.
Whenever a Zillion ults himself, unless he's tanking turret, I'm pretty mad at Killios because you got double bomb and then not much else when it comes to damage. Ult that AD carry, that's usually the way to go.
Once upon a time, that was enough for a Zillion to carry games, hit that double bomb.
That was a time before Spectre's Cal, before a lot of the mid laners that came through to outscale that early bust. It's still the same amount of damage, still has a lot of damage. And I think it lost 0.1 AP ratio at some point, but still is. Very good base damage and good scaling. But when you only have one damaging ability, probably want to ult the consistent damage. Although on MVP side, the consistent damage is what? Elise, maybe? With the W attacks? Renekton over a fight? They are very burst-centric, given that Jhin has that fixed attack speed.
I love that ADD has just gone for the locket. Might need it in a second here. Gets jumped on Songwon and Mickey coming out of the brush. Doesn't have anything to really slice and dice through, but still makes it out.
That's why it's interesting for Key, because when you don't have consistent damage on the side of MVP, you just want to negate burst, which is possible, but when you're also potential to be bursted, then you're in a lot of trouble.
Well, Realm Warp coming out, Mickey. He's going to take a short trip to the left, and will get himself out to safety. Nothing really on this bottom side of the map for MVP to take away, so likely just going to go back. Prep some waves.
Got all the easy objectives.
Get ready for, you know, another dragon.
All those easy objectives are down. Achilles, all six of the outer turrets have been taken on the side of the Tigers, who only picked up two themselves. Next Drake spawn is an ocean, which is another stack towards a potential backup win condition. It feels like this game has been going longer than 25 minutes, given
how accelerated it's been, yeah.
But that's just been solid macro from MVP and anything but that from the side.
Double bomb's thrown down.
Of Rock's Tigers.
We'll catch ADD, stuns him up, but won't take much damage, but won't be able to get in to lock anybody down. That's just going to be a TP expended on the side of MVP.
And apart from when they see all of MVP and Maokai can push up bot, not many jungle camps available to be cleared. Minions,
I mean,
when they're pushed, are there, but not that often are they pushed.
Look at the jungle of Rock's Tigers. It's lit up like a Christmas tree right now.
And none of the camps are alive.
Yep.
They're all dead, mostly taken by MVP. That's why the gold lead continues to increase. They're out of position for this mid lane push. Jhin can't do too much in this way.
I'm trying to wrap around from this side, but they might be able to get enough shots in. ADD bring out the control ward. They will go ahead and concede the turret. So Rock's minor victory. Still have to take what they can get, so should be pretty satisfied with that.
Absolutely. They're not really in a position to force many things. They have good rotational tools with the Sivir Ultimate and the Realm Warp, but from this far behind, when you can't really hope to take any fight, even 2v1 fights, you're like, oh, I don't know if we can kill them fast enough. That's a bit of a worry for the side of Rock's Tigers. QSS now completed for the Zillion, so at least an answer to either a silence or the suppression. More likely that he'll be able to cast the ult, but still fiercely squishy, of course. Look at that, 1,400 health. Stiff Breeze. We'll take him down. Not the Sungwan's overflowing with health either.
Yeah, not many people other than Mickey and Lindorong are. Mickey gonna recall. Oh, actually interrupts it, but they don't spot him out. Well, Morp will come through. They silence him. He's stuck up here. Max doesn't throw out the nether grass.
No damage in range, so no need to ult there. Also, QSS is finished for Kiki.
Yeah, you have to think if Maha was in range for a curtain call, that would have been a much different story.
Maokai starts to walk up from bot lane. No teleport on ADD.
Yep, he's just playing around top, keeping the waves moving towards the base of rocks. Oh, big burst of damage, almost goes down.
And that's the worry is that, sure, you can pretty easily twitch Chrono Shift the Syndra ulti, but if you die to the EQ, that's a lot harder to predict.
Yep, that's going to be MVP starting up the Baron, already down below half HP. Mountain and Infernal Drake doing wonders for them. I'm not going to connect Lindorong. He decides to go in, jumps onto ADD, pops the Dominus. Meanwhile, Max getting disrupted in the back line by Mickey. He's going to throw out the Nethergrass, flash over the wall, comes in, throws out the Q, will be able to take him down. Actually, Max picks him away with a Malefic Vision. So now that's three members of ROX falling after picking one ill-advised fight around the Baron. Flash away by Key, fourth shot, locks him up. Is it long enough? Yes, it is. ADD, he'll go ahead, commit the flash.
It's always a bad feel when the Chrono Shift's still up when three of your team have already died.
And also when you're respawning and you're surrounded by three members, four members of MVP. A near ace plus Baron for MVP.
You know what's exciting about this particular game, Achilleos? MVP look good.
Yeah.
They look practiced. They've accelerated the game in a really good fashion. They've spotted the mistakes from ROX and made good decisions on their own. There's no Fiesta about this game. From some struggles on the side of ROX Tigers. Takes two to tango in a Clown Fiesta, so we haven't seen one of those here.
Yep, gonna say nearly five kills picked up there by MVP, and it's still so early in the game that the death timers are short, so they can't push in for the inhibitor.
The ROX misjudging turret dives is one thing, but when they already when they already saw a 20-minute instant deletion of Baron, they needed to be more on point with their collapse onto the Baron, but again, it's dead before they're even get in vision of walking up to it. And then the turn predictable. There was no good ult targets for Key, so just ults himself. That arguably buys some time, but nothing more than that. This is what we call a no-hoper for ROX Tigers.
Yep, pretty much. Really rough spot to be in now, as it's an 11,200 gold lead. Ocean Drake to come through for MVP just because Elder will be the next one, but we might not even make it to see it spawn.
The MVP are going to keep up expectations. That should be their goal. This game should not last another 6 minutes. They're so far ahead. 11,000 gold ahead at 29 minutes. Not at 40, not at 45 like we've seen earlier this season. No real way to extend the game. Sure, Sungyun has good wave clear, but walks up and should be punished by one of the multitude of catch options MVP have. Could also consider just Renekton teleporting onto a minion and going for a turret dive, but there's a small element of risk there. One shot from Jin is enough to chunk down that outer turret. Brace is already broken in mid lane, so they could just rotate there as the minions come in. Baron buff, but another one more minion wave after this, maybe not even that.
Well, stun on the Sungwan. Won't get rooted by that deadly flourish. Still takes a bit of damage. Gonna have to peel back, double stun onto Mickey and Lindorong. Ian has been so accurate with these Scatter of the Week.
I mean, the numbers don't lie, clearly. 4-0 Syndra, soon to be 5-0. Since Syndra banned, just because it's so strong as a blind pick, or to not have to deal with the Corki Syndra matchup, and I think Syndra just needs to be banned against Ian.
I mean, honestly, how much is Ian really bumping up the win rate of Syndra? Because at the beginning of the split, it wasn't doing so well.
In Korea especially. Europe's still a very big pick. Other regions still a big pick. Hasn't been one other than for Ian in Korea. Should be the second turret going down or a fight.
ADD right in the front. Going to slice and dice his way. Trying to get out to safety. Bomb does explode onto Ian, but he is still relatively okay. Will peel back. Waiting for that Zillion
dies
ultimate
to
minions. Expire, but actually...
Sungwan might die to the dot.
Yeah, dies to the minion. Sungwan limping out. Will barely make it back to the fountain. Lindorong comes back up on the Zillion. So no one will die Just that mid and him going down in the long run here. Rock's able to hold on to the bottom, but they lose the turret.
Everyone's going out of their way to stack magic resist to hope to deal with the burst build from both Elise and Ian. Happiest time you could ever have stacking that lethality because...
True damage.
True damage. Not quite, but certainly close to it.
It's working towards that.
And no one's ever going to get anywhere near the Djinn. He can open up pretty damn close to Rock's Tigers. As only Lindarong is someone who can walk up, especially with Mickey having a pretty quiet game.
And just for extra measure, he's got the rapid fire cannon, so gives himself that additional bit of range.
The damning number for the Rock's Tigers is that Mickey, number 2 in kills, number 1 in kill participation in the league, a massive amount of kill participation, almost 80%, number 1 for damage share of any player. That already tells you, okay, Mickey's been the star of this team. Mickey has 40% of the team's kills. 40%, that's a massive number to have on one player, on a mid laner, no less, not even an AD carry. When he gets going, the team has an outside shot. He didn't get going this game, and it's been another one that you don't want to write home for the Rocks Tigers. Number one in kills in the league is Faker. He only has 32%. 32 to 34, I forget the exact number, but 40% is an insane statistic for Rocks.
Sure, that'll go up a little bit after today, since he did get quite a many few kills in that second game, especially on the Corki.
Rocks don't have a lot of kills when Mickey doesn't get going. They don't have a lot of idea of how to close the game either, unfortunately. Their best strategies are when he's on Corki and he actually gets a lead and he draws you to other lanes. Doesn't seem like anyone else on the side of Rocks demands attention. And speaking of demanding attention, that's the curtain call.
Yeah, curtain call coming through beyond the sidelines, so see quite a bit of damage from Mickey.
Well, he did miss all the shots, so maybe not.
Pops out the rotation, the rise rotation onto the Elise. Still does quite a bit of damage. So Beyond does have to back off, and the curtain call doesn't really get anything done for MVP. So this is just some downtime for Rocks to just keep farming up, try to claw their way back in, but it's still 11.2K.
It's going to be one of those weird situations where someone can look at the facts. If you didn't watch this game, you look at the stats, you can be like, man, it took 3 Barons to beat Rocks Tigers? What are you doing, MVP? But it's actually that the game has been decided by the first 2 Barons on spawn. It might be a 3rd Baron taken before 35 minutes, which is just insane speed given the respawn time.
I mean, they took it right at 20 minutes when it spawned, so it was really just well played by MVP so far.
Baron has not lived very long this game.
No, he hasn't.
What, maybe a combined minute? Because the fastest you could take it will be...
It was in the 27 minutes-ish when he respawned. And now he's going to be coming back up at about...
So he respawns for the 3rd time at exactly 43 passes. So he's lived for 43 seconds. That's insane.
It's a rough life.
I don't know if that's ever been beaten. That's very, very hard to find that stat, but holy. Might live a little bit longer this time, as finally it's not going to be an instant sneak from MVP.
Meanwhile, Rift Herald's like, hey guys. Help me out here.
Well, Mickey's overextended.
Oh, yep. He's going to get locked up. That's going to be the W.
Oh, he was actually ADD. Chrono Shifted, though.
Chrono Shift does come through in time, but Nethergrass follows up. He's got the big shield coming through. Max getting popped. He will
Rocks,
go
though.
Down. Ian, he goes low. He's going to get taken out. That's a kill picked up for Mickey. Now, can he find more? ADD is able to finish off Songyun. Maha sniping from the back with...
They go straight on.
Oh, wow. Actually, that's going to be... Yeah, right in there. Oh. Lindarong jumping in straight on top of Maha. And he pays for that one with his life.
Well, that was the wrong direction to Realm Warp. They Realm Warped into melee, range of an Elise.
Replay, please.
No, they just literally died.
Well,
time to kill Baron. You may not live, Baron.
I want to see a replay just to wrap my head around it.
The Realm Warp was a great idea anywhere except into melee range. All
right.
This actually looked like...
It started off really well.
Remember, there was like a billion gold advantage. We're talking like 12,000 gold advantage for MVP. They use everything on one member. The one thing they can counter is single target focus. You know, one member dies, you're like, okay, this is the one for MVP.
And then when Ian goes down, you think everything's fine.
Look, Sungyu dies in the back line, but it's just a Renekton. He's out of the fight. Get out of there. Lindarang tanking, and they go in. And instant deletion on the Ryze, who's at 500 HP, so... Mickey, not one to remember.
That was a Mickey play.
That was certainly a Mickey play.
I didn't even see the Realm Warp going up the lane. I just assumed automatically, they're going to take it out. They're going to escape. Lo and behold, Mickey baits Fates Slenderong to his death.
I just love the Realm Warp because you can have a year where Bjergsen makes the sick rotational Realm Warp and Mickey makes the opposite of that sick play.
So when is it a party warp?
I was going to just say.
When is it a party warp and when is it inting? Because the line is getting blurred almost right there at that point.
Let's give Mickey the minimum of credit. It was a party warp. Just wanted to party with MVP.
I don't mean to sound like I'm actually accusing Mickey of inting. I just think that he was very overconfident in his...
Sometimes you don't have to spell things out,
right.
Emilio.
Oh, dear.
Oh, Rocks Tigers.
Well, that's a fun clip for the front page.
Are we going to have Rocks Tigers versus Unicorns of Love in the quarterfinals and have Unicorns go back to their route? Because we could have quite the match.
Oh, boy.
The current Unicorns, sadly, aren't any fun. They just play smart League of Legends and win. Bring back the Udyr. Where's Kickus at? Sub him in for a tournament.
I'm sure the Unicorns fans are at home going, please, God, no. This is going great. Don't have to worry about anything.
They have to worry about quite a lot. Big match on, so after tonight's match, these guys go over to EULCS1. So that is a really big match there. G2 versus Unicorns of Love.
Yeah, could be an IEM preview.
It actually will happen at IEM because they're in the same group.
Ah, you're right.
So yes, there will be that match at some point. I'm very much looking forward to Kongdu Monster versus Unicorns of Love. That's going to be an interesting one. If Kongdu start the game well, they could win a game. They're probably not going to. They're probably going to get crushed, but... I'm excited. It's the sort of match that will never happen, right? When is Kongdu and G2 or Unicorns of Love going to be in the same tournament again? Maybe never.
Hey, man. Seoul said that they could beat everybody there. He's got the utmost confidence in his team. Just like MVP have all the confidence required to finish off this game. Sungwon is going to get locked down. Almost taken out. Actually manages to skitter his way to the fountain, but... It's going to be three inhibitors going down now. MVP looking to close this one out just before 40 minutes. See how long they want to stick around. Beyond did go quite low.
I do like that MVP either have the champions that only they play, like the Sion, where they're like, man, Sion win rate and LCK is very high. Or they're buffing up the Syndra and Renekton win rates. They're like, we can play this, I guess. Goes pretty well. Looking to end the game. That's why we see the teleport onto the minion. Massive load of minions coming in. Just the Nexus turrets to power through.
ADD stream back in.
Minion wave and the bot lane is quite far away and it's delayed, so that may actually extend the game. Okay. Walk up though, finally.
Song Yun's going to be quite adept at clearing out these waves with that Sivir, even if they are super creeps. Big stun coming through, locks up Song Yun and Key. He's going to get Nethergrass. Meanwhile, ADD going to be jumped onto the front line, has that Guardian Angel to lock it, buys him a hell of a lot of time. Lindorong goes deep, is able to help take out Beyond. Meanwhile, Max goes down, two members dead on the side of MVP, just the Zillion here. Four Rocks Tigers. Mickey comes back up though, gets popped immediately by Maha, who's just got too much damage on the Jhin. No real resistances to mitigate that damage. Nexus turrets will go down, but MVP can't stick around to try to clean this up.
Nope, not this time. Max and Beyond are down. The minion wave isn't in the right spot, so correct move is to back away, buy some items, extend the game, which has been decided for a long time now. That's why we're having fun times talking about everything else.
14,000.
Yeah, no analysis required at this point. 14,000 gold. It's been massive ever since that first Baron was taken down. Power spikes are not relevant. Items just decide the game for sure.
That feel when you're Song Yun, you know.
I agree. That feel when you're Song.
Flame Horizoning your enemy. Having the highest KDA on the team, I believe. And just unable to find a win.
Least consequential... Flame Horizons for 100. Yeah. We'll play Jeopardy over here. While we watch them play League of Legends, which at this point is probably grouping as five, killing someone through a zillion ult, and then ending the game. Jay being down on ADD means that can't brute force quite as hard.
Yeah, they just have to be worried about that Chrono shift. And see Lindorong. GA, ready to go for him. Stun not going to connect. Puts the advance in on ADD. Pops the Dominus immediately. We'll slice a nice back. Realm Warp here from Mickey, but it's popped immediately. Chrono Shift does make it onto him, but he's still coming back at half HP. Beyond goes up in the air, trying to lock down this Ryze. Won't be able to do so, and now Mickey actually trading back. Cocoon connects, however. That's going to be Ian swooping up the kill with the Scatter of the Week. Mickey goes down. Lindorong follows. And that is going to be the Nexus getting shattered here. Song Yun desperately trying to kite this out as best as he can, but to no avail, he will go down. Ian, barely going to live, almost gets popped by that Zil Bomb right at the end, but the Nexus crumbles, and that's MVP taking away game one. Pretty clean play, despite the extended game time.
It's been the kiss of death, winning a unfancied series like MVP's win over KT. So often, teams that have won those games have gone on to lose the next one, but MVP looked polished, MVP looked good, and Rocks Tigers looked anything but. A lot to improve after that particular game, the sort of game that you kind of have to throw everything out and go for an old pre-planned strategy, because I don't think a coach talk with the 8-minute break will be enough to really change all the litany of mistakes, the turret dives,
he's
the
got
lack
a smile
of
on his face.
Baron. Well, sometimes when all you feel is anger and sadness, it's best just to grit it out and smile, Achilleos.
It's the manicness. It's just setting in. The madness is consuming him. But, all right, well, very clean game from MVP. Good to see you after their follow-up victory over KT Rolster. So it seems like these guys are taking a step in the right direction. And if they close this out here with a 2-0, they will just slingshot their way into third place.
And opposition, though, was what we need to talk about a bit more. That was one of the worst performances I've seen from a team named the Rocks Tigers. Of course, most of those performances would have been this year. It was really poor stuff from them. Not what they want to have going into another series this week and also Intel Extreme Masters. Could be a long plane trip over to Poland, longer than already the flight duration for them. A lot to improve on for game two. They want to have any hope of making this a competitive series.
Yep. Kongdu Monster going to be going off on a win. Rocks, seems like it might just slip through their fingers yet again. MVP looking quite clean. They'll be swapping over to the blue side as we go to a break. We'll come back in for game number two and see if they can close this out swiftly or if Rocks will have an answer.